Only around 5% of the world's population have hazel eyes, yet a 2009 study found 55.2% of their Spanish cohort had hazel-green eyes. This eye colour is also more common in Portugal than the global average. But why is there such a concentration of hazel eyes in the Iberian Peninsula compared to most other parts of the world? And is the evolution of hazel eyes connected to the genetic history of Iberia? Now, there are two main types of hazel eyes. The first type has more green hues and is more of a hazel green colour. And this photo shows hazel green eyes compared to pure green eyes. The second type have stronger brown notes and are more of a hazel brown colour. Now, although anyone can be born with hazel eyes, they are most common in people of Brazilian, Middle Eastern, North African or Spanish descent. They are more common in parts of Latin America with higher Spanish ancestry, for example. Given the Portuguese influence in Brazil and the Spanish influence in various parts of Latin America, it's clear to see this connection to Iberia once again. But how did hazel eyes evolve, and does this connect to the genetic history of the Iberian Peninsula? Before we look at that though, I should quickly note the makeup of the region. Although Spain and Portugal dominate this area, the small landlocked country of Andorra is also part of Iberia. It sits in the Eastern Pyrenees between Spain and France. Its capital is Andorra La Vella. Now, Gibraltar is also technically part of the peninsula. It is classified as a British overseas territory, although it is at the centre of a long-standing dispute between the United Kingdom and Spain after it was ceded to Britain in 1713. A small part of France is also part of Iberia, but it is very small. What is interesting about Iberia though is that it has been at the centre of a genetic and cultural crossroads for millennia. On one hand, it has a strong influence from European forces associated more with higher levels of blue eyes, such as Western hunter-gatherers, Germanic and Celtic tribes. On the other hand, it has also had a major North African influence as well. This influence is associated more with brown eyes, of course. And it just so happens that hazel eyes are an intermediate eye colour. They sit almost perfectly in between blue or grey on one end and brown on the other. And this intermediate status actually speaks to the genetics of hazel eyes themselves. Now, this trait is a complex one, influenced by multiple genes, mainly those involved in the production and distribution of melanin in the iris. We know some of the key genetic factors involved though, which include the OCA2 and HER2C genes on chromosome 15. Now, these genes essentially control melanin production in the iris. People with hazel eyes typically have intermediate levels of melanin, meaning they do not produce as much as brown-eyed individuals, but more than blue-eyed people. Now, various other genes also contribute to eye colour. This breakdown shows some examples of other genes that could play a role, that influence factors like melanin levels, as well as how light scatters in the iris. But are hazel eyes a dominant or recessive trait? Well, eye colour inheritance in general is much more complex than we initially thought. This is because it is polygenic, meaning multiple genes interact rather than following a simplistic dominant recessive pattern. While brown eyes are typically dominant over blue, hazel is more variable and can result from a mix of genetic factors. Some of you may also be asking why hazel eyes seem to change colour. Well, their colour appears to shift between green, brown and gold due to various factors. One is really scattering. Similar to the way the sky looks blue, hazel eyes scatter light in a way that can make them look different depending on lighting conditions. Another factor is melanin distribution. Hazel eyes often have a brownish ring around the pupil, with a greenish or gold outer area. The balance of different types of melanin, such as eumelanin and pheomelanin, affects how much light is absorbed and reflected. Colours in clothing and surroundings can also enhance certain pigments in the iris, making hazel eyes appear more green or brown. Some people even report their eye colour shifts due to mood. When they're upset, they turn more green. When they're happy, they turn more gold. And please let me know in the comments below if you have hazel eyes and if your eyes appear to change colour because of your mood. Now, who was the first person with hazel eyes? Although this is an important and relatively simple question, the answer is actually far from straightforward. This is because the prediction powers of scientists isn't very good for intermediate eye colours like hazel and green, but it's pretty good for blue and brown. When it comes to brown versus blue eyes, scientists can predict eye colour with a very high accuracy rate by analysing genetic SNPs or single nucleotide polymorphisms, with the accuracy rate between 90 and 95%. Intermediate colours like hazel and green are much more elusive to predict though, with accuracy rates of only 50 to 80%. The reason for this is because the difference between blue and brown eyes is more clear in relation to melanin production. It is largely controlled in this OCA2, HER2 genetic locus. Intermediate colours such as hazel and green are less clear-cut though. There is a bit more mystery to them, and we don't really fully understand what causes them. And it's perhaps not surprising how many ancient cultures associated hazel eyes with mysticism and magic. After all, they are a trait that appear to change colour, depending on lighting, clothing, and perhaps even mood. Now, this is all to say that because of the less clear-cut nature of hazel eyes, pinpointing the earliest person with them is extremely difficult given the prediction methods we have today. However, we do know that hazel eyes today are often found in populations where blue and brown-eyed ancestry has mixed. If we extrapolate this a little, we know that brown eyes are very old in Homo sapiens, considered the original human eye colour going back hundreds of thousands of years. We also know that blue eyes are pretty old as well. Some argue that blue eyes could have first developed as far back ago as 42,000 years ago, much older than the 6,000 to 10,000 years you often see quoted online, which is based on a 2008 study. We certainly know that they are older than this though. A 2016 study, for instance, found this mutation in the HER2 area linked to blue eyes in ancient samples. These individuals lived between 14,000 and 13,000 years ago in the Caucasus in Italy. So a major first merging of blue-eyed and brown-eyed populations in Europe could have been when Western hunter-gatherers met early European farmers for the first time. We know that the former largely had blue eyes and the latter mainly brown eyes. This probably happened around 8,000 to 6,000 years ago. This could have produced some of the earliest people with hazel eyes if they are indeed caused by a mixture of these two genetic profiles. This leads to another question though. As this mixing happened across most of Europe, this mixing between Western hunter-gatherers and early European farmers, why is there such a concentration in Iberia today? Well, later episodes would have influenced the distribution of hazel eyes, and other factors probably played a role as well. We know that the Iberian Peninsula has been a major melting pot of European and North African ancestry in more recent history, unlike many other parts of Europe, such as Scotland, sunny old Scotland. Climate also may have been involved in these traits being selected for. From the perspective of geography, Iberia sits not too far north and not too far south. Hazel eyes are generally more common in temperate climates where moderate melanin levels are beneficial. From a logical perspective as well, it makes sense that they are not more common in Scandinavia or sub-Saharan Africa. Sexual selection could be another factor in hazel eyes evolving. Rihanna has hazel eyes after all, but I do go into more details on the reasons for hazel eyes in a previous video that I made that you should check out if you haven't seen before. But what about the genetic history of the Iberian Peninsula? What effect has all these different forces down through history, from Celtic tribes to Germanic tribes, the Romans to the Al-Andalus period, had on the genetics of this land? Well, the good news is there has been very specific research into this very topic, tracing the last 8,000 years of genetics in Iberia. Before we look at that though, if you're enjoying this video, please consider subscribing. And if you want access to exclusive member videos and other perks, check out my Patreon page. I will put a link in the description below. Or if you prefer to have everything on one platform, check out the members area of this channel on YouTube. Just click the join button to get more information. I recently posted a member-only video on the DNA and the fascinating role that hair played amongst royalty in the Merovingian dynasty of medieval Europe that is exclusively available either on Patreon or the YouTube members area. Thank you for your support and now on with the video. Now let's look to see how the genetics of Iberia has changed over the past 8,000 years. This study analysed the genetics of 271 ancient Iberians and compared them to thousands of ancient and modern individuals. For reference, before 8,000 years ago, Iberia was obviously home to hunter-gatherer populations. This study really starts around the time of the first farmers. They reached Iberia around 5,500 BC, or just under 8,000 years ago. Now, these first farmers brought Anatolian-like ancestry into Iberia as they moved across Europe from around modern-day Turkey. Around 4000 BC, this study notes that there was somewhat of a resurgence of hunter-gatherer ancestry. This is similar to many other parts of Europe around this time as well. Now if we move on a little into the Copper Age in Iberia, there was sporadic contact with North Africa. However, this North African ancestry only became widespread in the last 2000 years or so. We will discuss this again shortly. Now during the Bronze Age, from around 2200 to 900 BC, there was a massive change in Iberian DNA, with around 40% of ancestry coming from incoming groups. This was driven by a massive inflow of ancestry from the Pontic-Caspian steppe, known as steppe ancestry. Because of this, the DNA haplogroups changed dramatically around this time. Previously common Y-DNA haplogroups in Iberia, such as I2, G2 and H, were almost completely replaced by R1b M269. This was a lasting change, as we'll soon see. Findings from the study also indicate that there was more incoming males than females during this time, which other studies have also found evidence for, i.e. a male-biased migration from the steppe. Or is invasion a better way to frame it? Let me know in the comments below. But what happened to Iberian DNA during the Iron Age? Well, during this time, there was an inflow of ancestry from north-central European populations. This increase was anywhere between 10 and 43%, depending on the individuals analysed. The study notes that this introduction could be related to the Urnfield culture, with Celtic tribes also probably involved with the spread. Now, this leads us up to the Romans, but what impact did they have, if any? Well, during the Roman period, there was a shift in the ancestry of Iberia more to the east, in the direction of present-day Italians and Greeks. This shift was probably a result of increased movement across the Mediterranean because of the Romans. And on this topic, during the Roman period, there was also a major influx of North African ancestry, again probably related to this increased mobility. Some of this ancestry though could also be related to an earlier Phoenician Punic presence as well. Y-DNA haplogroups associated with the Phoenicians, like Gi2, became more common around this time. The Punic capital of Carthage in North Africa developed out of a Phoenician colony, of course, with the Phoenicians originally from the Levant area around modern-day Lebanon. Today, this haplogroup of Gi2 is still very high in the Eastern Mediterranean. Now, after the collapse of the Western Roman Empire, it was the turn of Germanic groups such as the Visigoths. The genetic impact of this seems to be limited though, although some samples shifted a little in the direction of North Central Europe. Around this time as well, it's interesting to note, this study also found an Asian mitochondrial haplogroup that appeared, called C4A1A. This may be related to the Huns in some way, or some other factor, but I'll leave that for another day. Now, in the last section of the study, the authors looked at a broad period between the 3rd and 16th centuries AD. 45 individuals were analysed from this time. As well as the findings already noted, they found additional Levantine-related ancestry that could reflect Jewish contributions as well. And obviously, during this time, there was ongoing gene flow from North Africa. This was largely a result of the Al-Andalus period of Muslim rule between 711 and 1492. Present-day populations from southern Iberia have less North African ancestry than the samples from this period though. This was probably the result of later expulsions and repopulations. So we have seen how the genetics of Iberia has changed quite dramatically over thousands of years, but what about today? What haplogroups are most common on the peninsula today? Well, if we look at the Y-DNA side first, R1b is by far the most common Y-DNA haplogroup in Iberia, found in around 60-70% of Iberian men. The subclan R1b-DF27 is especially common in Iberia, as this map shows. This R1b marker was first introduced in a major way with this steppe ancestry during the Bronze Age. Other genetic legacies are still felt though. Branches of E1B1B are at around 5-15% in Iberia today, such as EM81 and EV13. This mostly reflects this North African ancestry. The Y-DNA haplogroup Gi is also found at around 5-10% of the male population, both Gi1 and Gi2. This probably reflects various influences, including during the Roman period. I2 is also found in around 5-10% of men, and this is a very old haplogroup in Europe that likely goes back to early hunter-gatherers. On the maternal side, H is the most common mitochondrial haplogroup at between 40 and 50%. H1 and H3 are especially dominant in Iberia, reflecting European Mesolithic and Neolithic ancestry. Branches of U are the second most common maternal marker. U5 is linked to ancient hunter-gatherer ancestry in Europe, whereas U6 is associated more with North African Berbers. K, T, Gi, X and V are among other mitochondrial haplogroups found in Iberia. Now, I have made individual videos in the genetic history of Spain and Portugal that I would recommend for those looking for more information. But to find out more about the origin and reason for hazel eyes, please click here. Thanks for watching, please subscribe and hit the bell, and let me know your thoughts in the comments below. If you would like access to member-only videos, please check out my Patreon page or the YouTube members area. I'll put links below, or if you're on YouTube, just click the join button that's next to the subscribe button to find out more information. But yeah, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you next time.